Hi everyone. As I've been introduced, so my name is Etienne Bernard and I worked at Wolfram Research, and my job is to develop machine learning functions for the Wolfram language, so for the language of Mathematica. And that's what I will talk about today. So we'll talk in general about machine learning in the Wolfram language. Okay, so first to start, what do I mean by machine learning? In a very general sense, it's each time a computer learns a model from data. Okay, and it can be a very simple model, such as here, or more complex. So what I mean by model is, for computer scientists, it would be a program with tunable parameters that can be changed. And what we call learning is tuning these parameters to adapt these parameters using data. And so it can be simple models, for example, curve fitting, trying to figure out the y value as function of the x value, is already machine learning. It's a very simple form of machine learning, but it can be more complex, because if we want to predict what is an object in an image, then we might need a complex neural network, for example. And so where is machine learning used? So it's used in a various task, for example, for classifying images or classifying sound or text. Machine learning is a very useful tool, or to predict a variable in that data set, for example. Predict what is the height of a person as function of some attributes of the person. That would be another use case of machine learning. Another example would be text translation. This system will be designed with machine learning, or predict what is the future of a time series, or detecting if there are anomalies in some data. This is another task that machine learning is good at, clustering. Or for example, for a robot to learn how to move, machine learning can be useful there as well. And so in general, machine learning is separated in three learning paradigms. The first one, and it's a most known, is called supervised learning. So it is each time that you want to learn mapping input-output from example. So you want really to predict B given A, okay? And for that, you will give many examples of how A is transformed to B. So this is the most common paradigm in the industry. It's probably 95% of machine learning is supervised learning. But it's not the only paradigm. So another one is unsupervised learning. So is each time you give the machine, instead of giving the machine example of input and output, you just give machines example of data. There is no output anymore. And this is a paradigm that can be very powerful, but it's not yet used as much as supervised learning. But it's rising. It's used more and more. And there is a third paradigm that is called reinforcement learning. That actually I would prefer that we call it active learning, because it's each time an agent is active in an environment and has feedback from the environment. And so in a sense, the agent is creating its own data set, because it can, you know, decide to do some action in the environment, and this will give some data, but it can decide to do some other action. It will obtain other type of data. So in a sense, it's an active system that is creating its own data set. Okay, so you have supervised learning, we have input-output, unsupervised only input, and reinforcement learning where you have an active agent. So if we go back to the task that I talked previously, you can see here that this will be typically tackled using supervised learning. So you would give the machine a bunch of image of cats with the tag cats, a bunch of image of dog with the tag dogs, and the machine will try to figure out how to map input to output. This will also be supervised learning. You would give a data set with input and output. Okay. Text translation also supervised learning, input, output. Time series is a bit more complex, but you can also see it as supervised learning because you can give the history as input and the output is try to predict the next point. On the other hand, anomaly detection will be something that would be tackled most of the case with unsupervised learning. It's because in your data, you don't have data points that you know are good and data points that you know are anomalous. Usually, you just have data points and you assume that they are all good because anomalies are very rare by definition. So you would give all the data points that are good to a system, and this system will try to understand the structure of this data, try to understand, in a sense, to okay, in a general sense, to learn the distribution of this data. And each time there is a new data point whose probability density is very low, so something really weird, not common compared to the other data, it will say there's an anomaly. So this will be tackled with unsupervised learning. In the same way, data clustering is something that is tackled, it's an unsupervised learning problem. You don't have input-output, you just have data, and you ask, please try to find clusters in this data. Okay? And the final example would be for a robot to learn how to move, and this would belong to the class of reinforcement learning. There's no data set. The robot is just there in its environment, and the robot would try things, try to move the arm like this, trying to move the leg like that. And it will get feedback from the environment. It will know if, for example, the robot went forward or not. And from that, it will learn an appropriate policy to learn how to walk. So this will be an example of reinforcement learning. Okay, so sorry, I have the Zoom thing. Okay, so now in the Wolfram language. So what we developed the last few years is three types of functionalities. One type are the high-level functionalities. So it's a function that are designed to be very easy to use, very automatic. And then we have low-level functionalities, which is functions that are more for experts to do more complex things, and that's essentially neural network framework. And finally, using both high-level and low-level functionalities, we ourselves trained many machine learning models using our data, and we made function out of them. That's the first part. Okay, so let's see the first part, the high-level functionalities. So you have here a list of functions that I put into this category. For example, classify and predict are really the classic supervised learning function. And by the way, I will talk about classify and predict because I think this is a function that are the most useful. So the goal is to classify, is to train classifiers. So things that can, like the cat and dog example that I gave in the beginning. So this type of problem. Predict is a function to predict numerical value instead. Cluster classify, find cluster, it's function to do clustering. Dimension reduction, feature extraction, it's unsupervised learning function. We'll talk about it. And this is function that are more, about data mining, I will talk a little bit about it. So what's important is that they are very task-oriented. So you're not saying train this model using this objective function. Instead, you just say classify, and it learns a classifier. And they are automatic. You don't necessarily need to know the methods that exist or be an expert in machine learning to use this function. If you're an expert, there are some possibilities to give some options to be more specific in what you want. But if you're not an expert, so the idea is that really non-experts can use these functions. And they have to work on a wide range of data type, numerical data, images, text, and so on. So, okay, that's one type of machine learning that we developed. And the other one is quite recent. So it's the low-level functionalities, which is essentially a neural network framework. And there, it's much more model-oriented. So you really define by hand the model you want to use. And then you train this model on data. And you can use any type of loss function, for example. So this is very versatile. It can work for any type of, this can work for any type of this task. Okay? And it's more complex to use, but we try to make it as simple as possible. But on the other hand, it's much more flexible and you can get better performance by using this neural network framework. Okay. And so the final thing are the function we developed using machine learning. So I will present some built-in classifier, image identify, text cases, so things in computer vision, things in natural language processing, and so on. Okay. So actually, let's start with the built-in machine learning, since it's the simplest. So I will present just a few of the function we implemented using machine learning, and this will also give you the idea of what's achievable with machine learning. So there's a few built-in classifiers that we have that are, you can call through the function classify. So let's see an example. Classify language is the first built-in classifier that we did. So it's something that tried to predict a language. So maybe you didn't figure out, but I'm French, and so okay, it recognized what this language, and you can also ask what are the top probabilities. So it's pretty sure that it's French. And I can ask for the top three probabilities, for example. So it thinks, oh, it might be Italian and maybe Spanish, but you see with a very tiny probability. And this works for, all type of language. Actually, I have a Wikipedia here, so I think this is Japanese. It should be. So let's try this one. I mean, obviously, Japanese has some very specific character. So it's damn sure that it's Japanese. I think we can remove a lot of it. And it will still think it's Japanese. Starts getting... maybe this one is a... Oh. Is this also a Chinese character?
Yeah.
Okay, so that's probably why. So it's pretty unsure about this one. Okay. And but this one is since only Japanese, right? Yeah. Okay. So that's language. Facebook topic, I won't demonstrate it because I want to do something else after. What could I show you else? Oh, yeah, that's funny. Notable person. So this will tell you what famous person you look like. So actually, let me take a picture of myself right now. I'm at home, so sorry about the way I look. Okay. and let's put classify notable person, and I will put this one. And it will tell me that I look like, okay, Manny Pacquiao. Great. And you can do also, we can do a dynamic version of that. Dynamic version of that, and I will do a current image. Let's do, and I will classify the current image, and I will also show the image next by, right? And let's see the probabilities. top probabilities, and I want the top five, let's, or top three. Okay. Oh. Top three. Okay, and let's do a column as well to put one on top of each other. So here should let's see. Okay, you can see. All right. Okay, so I'm Jimi Hendrix today. Cool. All right. It's mostly American celebrities. I'm sorry about that. It was an experiment. We will add some more later. Okay. So another example is image identify. So this is very simple to use. Is just put an image and shift enter, and you try to figure out what it is. So this is a gray wolf. So this apparently didn't recognize. I think it wasn't sure enough that it was a lemon. So it went up the tree to say, okay, at least I know it's an edible fruit. And so this is something we train. So to tell you, this we train just with classify. I will show you an example after. And this we train with neural network framework. And it's trained with 10 millions of images, and that has been trained on a graphical processing unit, on graphic cards. Okay, so these are the built-in ones. And then there's some things for text processing. So for example, text structure. This is something that we'll try to figure out, so only for English, what are the part of speech, determiner, noun, verb, phrase. So this is doing grammar type thing. And text cases, which is more useful, I think. So let's try it by loading the Wikipedia page about the moon. And then I can say, give me all the sentences in the page. So this is pretty simple. It will just extract, cut the text into sentences. But then I can say, give me all the nouns and count them. So here it will use a bit of machine learning to figure out if words are nouns or not. And you can see the six time body, planets, satellites, and so on. And you can do other things such as extract all the sentences that are in English. So it will figure out that this one is English and this one it is, but not these ones. Or you can say, give me all the English and all the Spanish. And for each of them, give me the type, meaning English or Spanish, and their position in the text. And it will tell character 1 to 28. These ones are English, 51 to 66 are Spanish, and so on. So you can see it's a quite generic function. I think it's very useful for you can say, what are all the countries and so on, what are all the quantities, and interpret them. And it will understand, figure out all the quantities that are in the thing. So, and other possibility. So it's a pretty useful function, I think, for natural language processing. Okay, so now let's finish with built-in machine learning, and let's start with how a user can train their own machine learning problem, their own machine learning model. So one function I was saying is classify. It's very easy to use. You just have to give a data set here, which is four examples in that case. For example, example one says that if the input is one, then the output is A. Here it means if the input is three, then the output is B. And so if you run this, it creates a classifier function, and then you can use it on new data. For example, if I ask 1.6, you can guess that if 1 was A and 2 was A, probably 1.6 that is in the middle is probably A as well. And that's what the model thinks as well. And you can be more tricky, ask, 2.52, let's say. Okay, it will say B. And we can also ask for the probabilities. As I showed you before in the built-in classifier, it will tell that it thinks it's B 77% of chance and A 22% of chance. And that's important. All our classifiers are probabilistic. They can always return a probability distribution of the output given the input. Okay, so predict is similar, except that you see here that it's not a class anymore. It's not trying to figure out if it's A or B. Now it's trying to figure out which number it is. So it's a continuous value. And so if I do predict of this, for example, it will output a predictor function that I can use on new data. So if I ask for 1.6 again, that's the result that it says. And I can also ask for the probabilities, but since it's continuous, it is a distribution here. And so it says that given that the input is 1.6, my belief for the output is according to a normal distribution that is centered in 2.05, and plus or minus 0.07. Okay, so let's see now a more realistic example. So what I will do here is that I will load a bunch of Facebook messages. So let me show you, like, this is the first message, for example, awake at 5:30 on Saturday, driving to Maxville. And this has been tagged as talking about transport. I don't know, the third one, okay, family and friend, fourth one, okay, let's see. Okay, second one, ready for work tomorrow, blah, blah, blah. It has been tagged as career and money. Okay, so there's about, I don't remember, 20 topics. And we'll try to learn from the data set a topic classifier. So for that, let's see how much example there are. Okay, there's 470,000 examples. We'll just take the first 100,000 just to be fast. Okay, and I will use a test set. Let me also to be not so, let's take 20,000, the 20,000 next examples in a test set. So this is very classic in machine learning to separate the data into training set and then test set. And now we can train the classifier. So we just do classify and you can see the training set, what actually I could show you what it looks like. It's really like before, okay? It's just a list of examples with input and output. Input, output, okay? So let's put it into classify and you try to figure out which method it should use, which parameter, it does some experiments, and it should output a classifier function at some point. Did we put, oh no, I put 100,000. Okay, well, that's okay. Okay, it's done. So we can see this classifier, the method that it used. It understood that it was text as input, 100,000 example, fine, 26 classes. You can actually ask for other information. If you do classifier information, it will tell you that other information. And you can also ask for some many properties of information. That's all the properties you can ask to the classifier. Okay, but let's try it. So I can say now, I like to play piano. And yes, okay, so it figured out that it is music. Okay, and now let's do something fun, is that I have here dynamic, so I can start typing text, and it will tell me in real time what it thinks this text is about. So, okay, I like to play, so it's still personal mood, but I think as soon as I will hit the O, because it detected piano, the music suddenly jumped. And guy, 93% as soon as it figured out that guitar is there. Okay, so that's typically something that you could use for, consumer, you know, how do you say, when consumers are unhappy, they call the company because they have a problem. And it can be many type of problem, and this problem could be classified in different type and handed over different person to solve the problem, for example. So I think it's very useful use of classify. Okay, let's now show an example with image classification. So here, what I did is that I connected to Bing in order to search images with Bing. And I will ask for queries. I will ask for the query Centaur and the query Griffin that are mythical creatures. And I will try to create a classifier to identify mythical creatures. So let's add some other other creatures. So I don't know. Do you have suggestions of which creature we should add? I'm not expert. Is there some Japanese mythical creatures that you would like?
Pokemon?
Okay. I can add Pokemon, and I could add, let's see, what do we do? Phoenix. I like Phoenix. And if you have a fifth one, even, it's as you want.
Dragon?
A dragon, okay. Okay, so, and I choose this example because these are not in image identify yet. Mm-hmm. The step of an object, but not these ones. So that's why it might be interesting for you to train your own classifier. Okay, so now I'm going to download, let's say 20 images for each of these creatures, for each of these requests. Okay, so it's downloading. And let's see, actually, let's look at a few of them. Okay, so here you can see there's all the centaurs that have been taken, all the griffin, all the Pokemon. Oh, Pokemon is a bit more. Okay, there's some true Pokemon, but there's also some game things. So I don't know how good it will be, but let's see. And some some things. All right. So now let me label, I will delete duplicate and I will label the creatures. So now I also did a random sample. So if you look at data set, it will be a data set tagged. It will be, this is Pokemon, this is the Pokemon, this is Centaur, this is Phoenix. Okay. That's the data set.
Yeah.
And now let's, separate, so okay, let's see the length of this one, labeled creature. Okay, there's 100 of them, so let's use, let's say, 70 as training set, and we look at the 30, mm-hmm. Not much, but that's okay. The 30 other ones as a test set. Okay, now we can do same as before, classify of the training set, I put it in the variable C. It's training a classifier function. Mm-hmm. And okay, so now it's over. So it figured out there's five class, good. Let's see the first example in the test set. Okay, this one will be interesting. I have no idea if it will figure that out. Okay, it did actually, it did. And let's see maybe example four. Okay, example four we can try as well. Okay, so It seems to work a little bit, but to be more scientific, we're going to use the function classifier measurements. Mm-hmm. So as the first argument, classifier measurements, you put the classifier. As a second argument, you put the test set. And this will create a classifier measurement object on which you can query various things. So what really about is trying to figure out how well the classifier performs on the test set. So for example, you can ask simply the accuracy. Okay, it's pretty good. Mm-hmm. So this means that 96% mm-hmm. of the example in the test set have been correctly classified. And what you can ask, which is a bit better, is the confusion matrix. Mm-hmm. So this tell you the number of mm-hmm. each class that have been actually classified another class.
Wow.
So there's five dragons that have been correctly classified, seven griffin correctly classified, but there's one dragon that's been classified as Pokemon. Mm-hmm. So we can actually see them. So let's look at the, so I can say examples. Mm-hmm. And I want, first let's see the one that are correctly classified, dragon. Okay, there's one correctly classified. And now let's see the dragon that has been classified as a Pokemon. Okay, so this one. I guess it's a bit of a weird dragon. Yeah. So as you see, the results are pretty good. Even though we trained on only 20 creatures, not even because we took less, so maybe 15 creatures by class. And I told you that for Image Notify, you need millions of images. So why is that good? Is because we used a good feature extractor to pre-process the data. So actually we use Image Identify, the neural network of Image Identify, and we cut this neural network and we use the, in a sense, the first part of the neural network as a feature extractor. And this gives much better results because it already understood, this neural network already understands a lot about the image, even though it never seen any griffin. He probably knows what a dick is. He probably knows what these things are because it's so birds. So it's a bit like what us humans we do. We just need a very few example of a new animal to figure out, to recognize it in the future. So it's not as good as humans, but it's be the same principle. Because of this good feature extractor, you can train very easily image detector, image classifier. And that's one of the added value of this function, is that, yes, they are automatic, that's good, but also they know a lot about the data, they know about images, about text, about things like that, and to get better performance. Okay, let's speak now about feature extraction. So it's actually very close related to what I was just talking about extracting good features. So this function, which is a new function in version 11, the goal of this function is to convert any data set into numeric vectors. Okay, so vector of numeric values, numerical values. And what it does, what feature extraction does, this function, is learning a feature extractor from data. So very, very simple example. I have a data set, list of example. And as you see here, there's no input output because it's unsupervised learning function. So if I just do feature extraction of the data set, it will output a feature extractor function. And now I can use it on new data or let's say the original data, why not? And you see that it converts this example into numerical values. So in that case, it's very simple because it basically just converted, it copied this one and just converted the nominal variable, the categorical variable, into two binary numerical variable. But it can be more complex. So if I do something like this, this is another function. It's feature extract, which performs like feature extraction, but then extracts features of the dataset as well. Okay, it's sort of a one-shot function. And so you see here, you have text, you have a color, you have a date, and it transforms all that into numbers. Okay, and the way it does that is by first using some built-in feature extractor, such as the one for images, and then it performs dimensionality reduction. And this operation is very useful in machine learning. First, because many machine learning algorithms, they need numeric vectors as inputs, but also by learning a feature extractor, there's already a lot about the data that is understood. And so this vector will allow a faster training. In the same way as for images, because of feature extraction, we could learn a classifier much easier than without the feature extraction. And by the way, I did a blog post recently about feature extraction. So if you want, you can have a look where I explain these things more in detail. Okay. Okay, so let's see now some application of feature extraction. So the first one is data visualization. So let's get our images, okay? But now I will just flatten the images, and so there's no label anymore. So now if I look at images, it's just, okay, just a bunch of images. There's no output. And what we'll do with that is that we'll reduce first we'll extract features from these images. So let's construct a feature extractor. Feature extraction, and let's put the images, and it output it will output a feature extractor function. And then I will use this feature extractor function. So as you see, it understood that the type was images. Each image I converted to 99 numerical values. So I will apply this feature extractor to the images. Okay. So if I show you the results, it will be something, let's see. Okay. Let's see the first image. The first image has been converted like this, second image like that. Okay. And what I will do now is to reduce further these vectors to dimension 2. So now it seems very simple. You just have, for each image, you just have two values. And so of course, a lot of information has been lost in the image, but it is nice because now we can visualize where these points are. And so we use this. By the way, in the next version of Mathematica, there will be a function to do all that automatically, to be called feature space plot. All right, so let's see. Let's reduce a little bit. 600. Okay, here you go. So you can see here that I plotted this point and I labeled the point with the original image. And you can see that even though it didn't have any tag about images, you still have all the phoenix that are here, all the Pokemons that are here, and apparently it's a bit of a mix here, but you have more of the centaurs that are here apparently, and oh, the griffin, oh, it's because there's a dragon as well. Okay, there's a lot of confusion between the dragon and the phoenix. But you see, it understands a little bit how to separate things. That's one application. another application, and I will try to show that faster. Let's take the first, so I think we had 100 images. So let's take the first, actually 95. As data sets and the rest as query images. So what I'm constructing here, what I want to do is an image search system. So a search engine, like Google, but instead of putting text, you put images. So let's train a feature extraction. And so for creating this search system, we'll actually do the search in the feature space and not in the original space of pixels. So here I'm creating a nearest function for dataset in the feature space. And this will output the nearest function, and this nearest function, I create a function now that will apply, so it will take a new data, extract its features, find the position of the nearest element, and then it will grab the image, okay? And so this thing, if we ask for the queries, if we look at the queries, if I do nearest creature of this thing, it should tell me what is the nearest element dataset. And you can see on this example that if here the background is white and here the background is green. So if you were looking pixel-wise, these two images would differ a lot. But because of the feature extraction, because the feature extractor understands what the data is, in a sense, it will give a more semantic output. So let's see this centaur. Again, it's a centaur, even if the color kind of differ. And we can try also a phoenix. Okay, this is pretty clear. So this is how you can construct a you know, image search system. Okay, maybe I won't show this example because we don't have much time. Okay, that's another application of feature extraction, is to impute missing values. You can learn from data set how to recover the missing values. Like if you give new examples that are missing values, it will be able to figure out what are these values probably. Maybe I will show you if I have time. But I want to speak a bit about neural networks. So So there's some other function. The idea is, like, given data, you find clusters, and it will figure out there's two clusters. You can also specify. No, exactly, there were clusters. So that's the thing that it found. Let me show an example. Very, very simple example. If you have two clusters and you find clusters of the data, and I do a list plot, it will actually figure out the two clusters. Okay, very simple to use. Find distribution, find formula. I can talk a little bit. So these are a bit different function to classify and predict, in a sense that they don't just care about doing good fit. They also care about having a highly interpretable model. So let's start with find formula, actually. Let's actually even just talk about find formula. So what I do here is that I generate some data according to a formula plus some noise. And if I do list plots of this data, you can see the data. And find formula will try to figure out, is there a simple formula to fit the data? So in a sense, it's automatic fitting. So I do shift enter and it tries various things. And in that case, it actually found the formula that we generated the data with. Okay, and so we can plot the fit, and so it found the formula. So that's good. So it's not a function to give a good fit for any type of data. It's really a function that you ask, okay, here is the data. Is there a simple formula that fits the data? Maybe there's not. And if there's not, it will give something very bad. But if there is one, then for example, if you're a scientific, you can ask the question, why is it that simple? Maybe there's a theory behind it. So that's what these functions are for. So a bit different to other machine learning functions. They're more what might be called data mining function, because we want to understand the data rather than just model it. Okay. And now if I can spend maybe 10 minutes more, and then we should give time for questions. Let me talk a little bit about the, I don't know, can we take 5 minutes more after the time, or? Anyway, let's see. So recently in version 11, we added a neural network framework. And so the idea is that you can define arbitrary neural networks, and you can train them on CPU, on GPU, so on graphic cards. It uses MXNet in the backend. And it's quite of a high level framework. So it's a bit, for those that knows a bit about deep learning, it's a bit like Keras. So harder to use, of course, and classify and so on, but much easier to use than TensorFlow or other type of low-level framework. And so there are many layer types, and there will be a very important update in 11.1 with recurrent layers and so on. So if you're interested in that, really, okay, so, and this is an example of a net graph. So this is our representation of a network, and here you have various layers, and so you can click, and it can tell you what this layer is, the port that it have, the way that it have, so you can navigate the network like this. This actually is in black, which means there's more than one layer. So there's actually many, many layers in this one. And you also have numbers that indicate you the size of the tensors that are passed through the system. And actually you can probably, oh yeah. Okay, so I can also figure out what are these layers. So we try to have a very interactive approach to doing neural network. And let me show you one example at least, which is a very classic conversational neural network. Actually, it's the first neural network that had been developed 20 years ago by Yann Lequin. I thought that was a question. So for that, let me download some handwritten digits. So let me show you what it looks like. So it's separated into a training set, a data set. Okay, there's 60,000 of them, and it's like this. So this is says, this is a zero, this is a four, this is a two. Okay, so it's a classic problem in computer vision. And here we are defining a neural network, a convolutional neural network, that will take as input an image and output the probabilities that it thinks this image is for each class. It will output the probability that it thinks for zero, for one, for two, and so on. And each element here, so here you see it's called net chain because it's a chain. So this is the first operation that will be performed on the image, then this operation performed, then this one, and so on. Okay? And this is a convolution layer, so it's the idea is you have a window that is going through the images and computing numbers, and you have many of these windows. You actually have 20 windows, and they have a size 5 by 5. And this is a non-linearity. So the convolution will actually perform a linear operation, and the element-wise layer ramp. Ramp is this function. It will perform a non-linearity. All the values that are above zero, it will keep them unchanged. And all the values that are below zero, it will clamp them to zero. Okay, so it's a classic network. So let's train it. So you can see the network and you can look a bit at its layers. And then you can use the function netTrain to train this layer, this network, on the training data. And we'll also specify the validation set is test data. Okay, so let's train it. And here you see you have an interactive window that show you how the loss function is behaving as the training goes. And so you see that the loss function is getting down, which is good, which means the network is learning. And you can see that for now, it didn't even see all the data. Now it sees like a quarter of the data. but it already seems to kind of stabilized. It's still going down, So you can wait until it's over, or if you're a bit impatient, like I am right now, I can just do stop. And it gives me the last train network that it has. And then I can try it on new examples. So let's get things on the test set. Test data, I think it was called. Right, so if I take the first file, let's do a random sample. Random sample, and I take five of them, and I can ask, okay, what do you think this one is? That's a bit of a weird one. Oh, sorry. it's called trained. And we say, okay, it's a 7, good. So it's apparently working. Okay, so you can see, and I could give all of them. And okay, so it learned to recognize digit. And without any feature extractor, this is really from scratch, just using this neural network. Okay. So I had another example about neural network, but maybe since we have 10 minutes, we should use that for questions. Maybe, okay. Quickly, maybe I can show you this one. Maybe we don't do it all over. So this is a network that is able to, at what they call an autoencoder. It's a network that will encode data to an intermediate representation and then decode this representation to try to decode original data. So a bit like compression. This will be compression, this will be decompression. And what we need to do for that, let's say these are the data that I give, let's construct this network. So it's just a simple net chain that will encode these two-dimensional values into one-dimensional value, so just a simple numeric value, and then decode it back to two values. Okay, that's an encoder and decoder. And what's interesting here is that we have to create our own custom loss network. And this loss network has basically to, if you see, it has to take as inputs the original data, take as outputs the decoded data, and then compute a mean square difference between this and this, and this would be the loss. So we need to add this loss layer. And for that, we'll use a layer called mean squared loss layer. And let me just explain. And so for that, we need a net graph. And so let me just explain what this syntax is. Here, it's not a net chain anymore. It's not just operations that are simple operation after another. Now it's a full graph. So there's two layers in this graph. The first layer is a network we have here, our encoder. The second is our loss layer. And what this means connect the output of this layer to the input of this layer, because this is layer number one, this is layer number two. So that's what you put, one goes to two. But then we need to do something more complicated, because we need to connect the input of the whole network to a port that is called target into the mean square loss layer. So you can imagine this, these layers as being small computation units with some ports around. And you have to connect the ports of some layer to the ports of other layer. And so this means connect the port input of the network to the port of the second layer, so this one, that is called target, so this port. And here is what it looks like. So the input is given, the input goes to the autoencoder, then the result of the autoencoder is given to the mean square loss layer, and the input is also given to the mean square loss layer in the target port. So this one goes to the input port, this one goes to the target port, and the loss port that is here compute the loss function. And so then you can train the loss net, and you see again the loss function that goes down, and okay, let's stop it here. And now what I will do is I will extract from this network just the layer number one. So I'll do net extract one. So it's just the autoencoder, but now it's a trained autoencoder. And now I can just use it, and I will stop here with this example, to show what this autoencoder is doing on data. Basically, if you have a point here, it will project the autoencoder, project the data point to the manifold of the data. So it learned a dimensional reduction of the data. Actually, let me just show you quickly. Okay, this is the color represents the value of this one-dimensional code. And maybe this one will be a bit more clear. Okay, that's really what this network does, is that it figures out in this data that there is a manifold. And it will encode, it will project all the data onto this manifold.